Cheers, it's Rob here in Brooklyn, New York at the wonderful Spritz House.
And we're here.
Spritz House.
Spritz House. Go. And we are, and the topic of conversation today is beer. I'm here with some fine gentlemen, some fine drinkers of the of this wonderful beverage.
True.
We have Alex and Seth representing Beltins, a wonderful brand of Belgian beer. And of course, drummer extraordinaire and beer connoisseur extraordinaire, Richard Christy, who's way further along with his beer than any of us.
You guys got to catch up.
All right, we're far behind.
We want to talk all things brews. Well, let's start with this one. Tell us about this beer.
This is a perfect beer. Mm. This is a Pilsner. This is, I think, the textbook definition of the style. Mm-hmm. Traditional, balanced, easy drinking, very clean, very chuggable. They started in 1824, fifth generation, family-owned brewery in the middle of the mountains about an hour east of Cologne in Germany.
Yes.
They found a nice source of water in the ground, and that was 1824. They haven't moved since. They're still pulling up the best, most pure, cleanest, softest water. And that's what it's all about with this style of beer.
And to this day, the back in the 1500s, there was the purity laws that were passed in Germany.
Where you
could only brew beer with certain ingredients.
Four ingredients.
And they still abide by that today in the brewing process.
Well, I know for me, when I showed up here, I was so sweaty and gross and hot. And this like quenched my thirst and like...
It's medicinal.
This is a great beer for a nice hot summer day.
You got it, yeah.
So this is the Pilsner. Now, I am not as much of a beer connoisseur as the three of you, so I'm going to be asking some basic bitch questions. What's the difference between a Pilsner and, like, let's say a lager, which is a more traditional type of beer, like a bar?
A lager is a square, and a Pilsner is a rectangle. You know what I mean? So they're both, a Pilsner is a lager with a little more specifics to it.
And what would be the specific, what distinguishes a Pilsner from other lagers?
Lager is more, there's more variations. It means bottom fermenting yeast. Mm. That's really all that delineates
so
a lager.
It's like a very wide ranging term.
Yep, that's the start. And then you want to get fancy, make a Pilsner out of it. You want to make a Helles out of it. That's up to you. A Helles lager is probably about as light and bland as it is. And that Pilsner has a little more flavor than that.
You know, if you give it a quick smell, I mean, what do you get from that when you smell it?
Wet towel.
I don't get a horse blanket.
I've had Pilsners that were a little peppery, even almost.
Oh, sure. Yeah.
I love that.
Well, and then there's all kinds of microbreweries making Pilsners in their own different way, which is very hoppy or a little more intense, a little more flavorful. This represents the old school, just traditional, simple. Perfect, in my humble opinion.
And now this is a pretty standard beer mug.
Yes.
But some of the beer we're going to be drinking later on in this video is not in a standard beer mug, like that glass over here.
Yes.
How does the glass, the style of glass, affect the taste? Like, why drink from a different type of glass?
A lot of these Belgian breweries, it's like they've designed the glass before they even make the beer. That's as important to them as the liquid and the ingredients.
There are so many crazy beer glasses now too.
Like yes.
There's IPA glasses.
Oh yeah.
You know, and my wife and I went to Belgium and it's so cool out there where you go to a bar and they'll, even if the glass is covered in dust because somebody hasn't ordered that beer in so long, they'll bring out the glass that has that beer's logo on it to match with it. You have to have that glass.
They won't have a beer on the menu without the proper glassware to go with it.
It's amazing.
For a true beer connoisseur, you need the proper glass for the proper beer. You can't just throw it in any old pint glass.
And certain cultures, like Germany and Belgium specifically, they're really, really adamant about that. I think there's some nice, really high-quality beer establishments in the U.S. where they're a little more lax on that, as long as it's served at the right temperature.
But what's the science? What's the science for it?
You know, every beer has a different head when you pour it. Some beers actually require a bigger head than others for the taste. So, but it's a lot of it is about style too.
I see.
Yeah.
And
for some, there's actually meanings behind the glassware that they created.
You know what I used to do, and I've since stopped because a craft beer friend of mine yelled at me for it. I used to make the mistake of I'd put my beer glasses in the freezer, and they were like, "Oh no, that's the worst thing you can do."
Why, years ago. What did he say? Why was it too bad?
Because it ruins a lot of the flavors and the you know the smell that you get from it. Your beer has to be at a certain temperature, and you want your glass at a certain temperature.
It numbs the flavor a little bit.
It does. Yeah. It really
and sometimes
does.
If it's a light, kind of crappy beer, that's a good thing.
Yeah, yeah.
You know?
But so, we're not drinking light, crappy beers today.
No, sir.
Right? We don't want no frozen glass.
Yeah.
So this first beer, it looks like it's a seltzer, but it very much is not.
Looks like really expensive water.
Yeah. So it is a, how do you pronounce this? Grisette?
This is a grisette. Yeah, that's the style of beer. It's made by Saint-Fuyen. It's one of the 21 Abbey breweries in the world. Have you heard of like Trappist beers? Beers made by monks?
Okay, let's hear it.
Back in the day, a couple centuries ago, most beer was made by monks. And it's kind of a historical, traditional, cool cultural thing in Europe. And there's still maybe 12 Trappist breweries in the world now. Abbey means it used to be made by monks, and now, you know, it's hard to get a lot of monks. There's not a lot of them in the world right now. And this is an old traditional historical brewery as well. 1873, they started out. And they're in the south part of Belgium where they speak French, hence the name Saint-Fuyen.
You want an angle on this style of beer?
Yes, you want an angle and plenty of head.
Now,
I'll hook you up.
Why would you want the angle? Well, what does the angle do?
It just helps give you a little more head right there.
Ah.
See so that? It's alive.
It's beautiful.
Moving around, it's just glowing.
What classifies this as a grisette?
Grisettes were brewed, I believe they're brewed in the winter to be drank in the spring, summer by miners. Not people under 18, but people who mined.
Like coal miners.
Coal miners, exactly.
Skull.
Yeah, so.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, get a good smell of it, too. Very.
Oh.
What do you get?
Lemon.
I like it. This is great. I like the little fruity aftertaste.
Yeah, a little citrusy.
It's very light,
spicy.
Yeah.
A little salty, too.
Yeah, a little bit.
Yeah, I mean, everyone's palate is different. You know, everyone tastes different, but. And it's interesting when you kind of do these tastings, how everyone kind of gets something different, you know, salt and...
There's no wrong answer.
Yeah. Yeah, so it's kind of interesting
unless
to hear...
Wrong.
Unless you're wrong, which...
Give me a few more of these and I'll have some wrong answers.
My thing is, people with sour beers say horse blanket.
Horse blanket.
When have you ever licked a horse blanket?
Yeah, I grew up on a farm. You know? I've done some weird things.
This tastes like horse blanket.
I've licked a lot of weird things on a farm.
Okay.
You don't want to ask someone about tasting notes. Yeah.
that's true. Maybe
you know what I get from some beers that I actually love that might turn some people off is my grandma had an attic with a real musty, crazy smell. And there's certain beers now, craft beers, you get an attic smell, and it brings back great memories.
I get musk a lot from certain things.
I love that.
And in a good way.
Yeah, in a good way, definitely.
That's another thing. You wouldn't think you'd want to like bottle or drink attic air or lick some attic dust, but...
That's a great name for a beer, attic air. Attic air lager.
Yeah. I love these glasses. I feel like I'm in Game of Thrones right now.
And this glass brings out the smells of this beer.
Yes, wide mouth. And you hold it here so you don't have to hold the part where the beer is warm. So you don't warm it up.
Yeah, you don't want to be all, you know, like...
That makes perfect sense. That's great strategy. You want to keep the
very, very refined.
Yes.
I might have to be the wuss that does the... I gotta pace myself.
It's okay, man. Don't worry.
Be honest. The Saison, which I would always say Seosin, completely wrong.
Isn't that a band?
Probably.
Now, what is a Saison?
Like, this is also a genre. Means season. This was for the coal miners. This is for the farmhands.
Yeah, and at the end of their harvest, you know, at the end of the harvest, they would brew this beer for the next season. Also, all of these that we're drinking, it's very seasonal for now. You know, because a lot of beers, they're brewed, they're seasonal beers, you know. Yeah. We're not really going to serve like a porter, you know, or like a very dark, heavy, you know, Russian stout that we're going to drink, you know, in June.
Let me try this porter.
Yeah, there you go. Don't be afraid ahead. There you go. Oh, yeah. Beautiful.
Yeah.
Beautiful.
And if you notice, yeah, I mean, beautiful. So we have the grisette. If you notice, just the color is different already.
Yes.
Yes.
This beautiful. Is like the type of urine when you haven't had any water the whole day. That's what this looks like.
And, and you've taken a bunch of vitamins.
Back in the day, when monks were brewing beer during the 1200s, perhaps.
They didn't drink water.
They couldn't drink water. The water supply was tainted.
Oh, wow.
So a lot of the hydration came from beer. Because you got to boil the water. Everybody. Kills all the bacteria.
Children would drink beer.
Yeah,
and everything.
It's really low alcohol beer.
Yeah.
It's saved. That's the reason why we still exist as humans. Yeah. Perhaps without beer, we might not have made it this
Thank
far.
You, Thank you, beer.
Hey, I know without beer, I wouldn't be here right now.
Thank you for life, beer.
Oh, man.
This is so good.
This is so good.
Oh, this is delicious.
Yeah, and actually, we're really excited because the cans for Grisette actually just came over to the U.S.
A
couple weeks ago. Yeah. So this is brand new to the U.S.
Yeah.
And even Saisons I haven't seen in cans a lot.
Yeah,
these
were actually
the first one.
Yeah,
first
these were
really
to put it in a can.
Yeah, and before this, it was in a different can. It was in a kind of a taller, thinner can.
Yeah.
And they kind of redid
it. I love
it,
that.
Because
Saisons I love, like, this time of year in the spring or early
perfect.
Summer. Like, you could take this to the beach or where they allow it.
Yeah.
What are the benefits of a can? Like you just said,
from I've heard a lot, it's that sunlight can't affect the beer if it's in a can.
And even a bottle cap over time lets in a tiny little bit of air and oxygen.
I see the sealing is much better on a can.
Also, that's what people love cans right now. This does not exist in the home market in Belgium. Yeah.
Now that I've had these two beers next to each other, this beer was very light. It was almost like a water, like a flavored water.
Yeah, very light.
Whereas this, I definitely feel a heavy, not a heaviness, but
heavier.
It's a little heavier than the grisette that we
For
tried.
Sure. Yeah, this you can pair this with a little bit bigger of a food, maybe a burger or some
rack of ribs.
Some spicy ribs, some fried chicken.
Yeah, and that you know, that's important too. I mean, especially when you're pairing with food, you know, you want to make sure you have the right beer to go with the right kind of food.
Yeah, like a steak is going to have a different beer than chicken wings or something.
Right, right.
Yeah,
right.
Pasta.
Your pasta, yeah.
Cereal.
Yeah. Are you putting the beer in the cereal?
That's the best pairing.
It really
with cereal,
A good milk stout is
Saison and Lucky Charms, I heard, is very, very delicious.
The good pairing?
Only in the spring, though.
It's almost like I can smell the fields of all the ingredients, and it just smells like a farm. I love it.
Time, farm, vibe going on.
Oh, it's so delicious.
This is really good. Like, what metal would go with the Saison right now? Like, what do you
farm
mean?
Metal.
Folk metal.
Yeah.
Farm metal.
Yeah, we gotta create a new genre, farm metal.
Yeah.
What does that sound like?
Evil tractor.
Omer. This is from Belgium. Brewery Omer Vandergenst, which is their family name. I think they're on their sixth generation.
Oh, and they've won the gold medal in the World Beer Cup in 2010.
Bing bang boom.
That's big time.
And the ABV's up to 8 on this one.
Yeah, so we're getting a little...
We're going up.
We're climbing the mountain.
We're ascending the mountain.
It's a beautiful bottle design, actually.
It's cool, right?
It looks like a vase, almost. It's like much...
Yeah.
Like the curve here is so... It's very European.
Totally. And this logo, it looks like stained glass, right?
Yeah.
So back in the day, they would put that in the windows of their bars so that you would know what beer is being served at the bar. It was like the original neon.
Oh, that's cool.
Yeah, and of course, the glassware.
And now look at this. This is
a beautiful glass.
This is just...
And you want to try and pour this?
Yeah. Now, what's the pour on this?
This one's slower, a little bit slower than the cans, because this has a lot more carbonation.
So you don't want the head.
But you still want the head, but it just will create it for you a little easier.
Is this good?
As you can see, yeah.
Am I nailing
it?
A
little more, yeah.
Cheers.
Skull. Cheers, gentlemen. Skull. Oh, yeah.
Oh, wow.
Smells like a beer.
Oh, yeah.
Very,
little richer, a little bigger, more body to it.
That is
delicious.
A little
more sweetness. Oh, yeah.
The U.S. craft beer, you know, industry is huge. I mean, everyone, who's everyone has a craft beer. And, you know, our goal is to introduce this to everyone saying, hey, try something new, you know. I mean, this stuff has been around. They know what they're doing. They've been around for hundreds of years.
Which nation is most associated with beer? Would it be Belgium or Germany?
I mean, America is crazy right now with how many breweries there are.
Yeah, we have over 5,000 breweries. I bet we have the most right now because Jesus.
But with history, I would say, I mean, Belgium and Germany is, you know, historically have been brewing for the longest.
You know, it's interesting, a lot of, at least for me, a lot of, you know, when I go to parties or if we're, you know, we're going out to friends' houses, I don't bring bottles of wine, really. I bring, like, really good bottles of beer.
Yeah.
And say, hey, try this. And then they'll say, okay, we'll crack it open. And they'll be like, wow, this is really interesting. Mm-hmm. And then, you know, it's just, you know, everyone can bring a bottle of red wine, you know, and a bottle of white wine.
But to introduce somebody to a beer style they've never had before.
Yeah, like, oh, you know, my gosh, what is this?
Check out this barley wine. You know, a lot of people haven't had a barley wine. It's fun to see people try that for the first time.
Yeah.
You just got to let them know, you know, don't drink this like it's a natural light.
Drink this out of a bottle.
Yeah.
I like how we're always going back to Natty Light.
Oh,
like,
I drank so much of that when I was younger, I don't even want to.
Yeah. Natty Ice.
My big one was Milwaukee's Best Blue Beast. And Red.
Oh. Yeah.
The Beast, yeah. The most I ever drank was 21 Olympias one day.
Wow.
Because I saved the tabs and made a necklace out of it. I ended up puking all over this girl's Trans Am hood. Like, you know, the Trans Am hoods had that eagle thing
on. Yeah, the eagle on it.
Like, I covered that eagle with vomit.
Hey, you're decorating a little bit.
It was Olympia, so it just washed off real easy, but still.
So now we have clearly the most unique glasses we're going to be drinking out of. This is the only glass I've ever seen that has its own, like, holder.
So this beer, this is a brewery called Bostiels out of Belgium. And this is called Quack. 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 So the idea behind the iconic glass is when the Powell Kwok, many, many years ago, he owned a brewery and an inn in Belgium. And quite often, you know, horse and carriage riders would come around, men who would drive carriages and take passengers, they would come around and they would get very thirsty and they would want to stop and have a beer. But they couldn't leave their carriages because they couldn't leave the passengers alone in case, I don't know, they would steal the horses. So he created this glass, and on the carriages was the holder where the glass would go. So the carriage riders, just this part, so the glass would actually fit in right on the carriage, so the carriage rider would not have to get off of his carriage and would be able to drink it as he rode the horse and carriage.
Wow. And did he take the glass out of the holder while he drove?
Yep. Yes. Yeah, but this would actually hold it on the carriage for him as he drove, so he wouldn't
go
have
over
to
a bumpy road, you know, doesn't fall out.
And there were no such thing as DUIs back then.
Exactly.
apparently. A CUI or whatever. Carriage under the influence.
Yeah. It's a great gimmick, buddy.
Wow. So this is a lot of head here.
Oh yeah.
Wow, that's Look beautiful. At it. That's beautiful.
Now this beer isn't as carbonated as the Omer, the last one we had. So that's why you need to pour it with a little more attention to the foam.
Let's go.
Let's go.
Chris.
Let's go.
Yeah. Oh, that's
as
so
the beer
sweet.
Travels through this little passage here, kind of re-energizes, recarbonates. So that by the time it hits your lips, it's always foamy.
Oh, that is perfect.
This is bigger. This is a lot more malt, a lot more sweetness, a lot of caramel.
A lot of caramel.
Oh, yeah.
You can definitely taste the caramel, like
nougat, caramel.
It like yeah. It's like an alcoholic candy.
Yes. It's like that you could it's have like while driving. It's
like
a
something.
Carriage.
Yeah, it's like something you would find in your grandmother's purse in beer form. It's like one of those old grandma candies. Yeah.
Beer always reminds you of grandma.
Hanging out in my grandma's purse in my grandma's attic.
My grandma was a loser.
You know, and my I'm thinking King Diamond. Maybe?
Yeah, this is a King
Diamond. Yeah, we do a King Diamond collaboration.
There's a bar in Belgium, I forgot what town, but you know, quad glasses break and disappear easily, so they got a little pulley system where you have to donate a shoe. Give the bartender a shoe, you put it in a basket, pull it up to the ceiling, and you get your quad glass. When you return the glass is when you get your shoe back. It's kind of fun.
This one, the glass, probably more than any others, is so integral to this beer because it see how it's small right here. It doesn't let the carbonation
evaporate. So keeps it in.
That's the point of the like bottleneck.
But then it's still wide, so you can get the aroma. But then the bottleneck, yes, when it passes through here, creates more carbonation.
Oh, interesting.
This is the same brewery, the Bastille's Brewery. Now this we pulled from draft, so it's not as on the bottle. It's like the Omer, just exploding with carbonation. On draft, it's
like,
a little smoother.
Like all of our beers, we have to drink it out of the proper vessel.
There's a very strong aftertaste too. I feel like if you taste the beer, it's like yeah, you just drank me. Like very floral scent, it seems.
Yes.
So
citrusy, floral, bright. Yeah.
I can see a guy drinking this right before he gets burned up by a dragon. Yeah. His last great drinking
me.
Your last drink, sir, before you die. Talk a little bit about the difference between draft and bottle. So.
The bottle is bottle conditioned, so before they cap it, they add a little more yeast. So what that does is it really, really livens up the body of the beer, makes it super carbonated, like the Omer, perhaps even more.
What's the perfect amount of time that it bottle conditions?
It's a good question. I don't know.
Maybe a month or two?
But you could drink it several years later and it will still be really alive.
There's so many beers now that there's even articles that people will write about when to cellar and when to bring something out.
This is pretty regal too.
Yeah.
I mean,
oh wow, that's a beautiful
to me it's
glass.
One it's this or this. I don't know. If you notice right in the middle of the glass too, there's the beer logo.
Oh wow.
And it's kind of it's got a little texture to it. You pour the beer in there and it creates bubbles from that point.
From that
actually,
logo.
We should look at that when you pour this. I forgot to bring that up. La Trappe Quadruple.
La Trappe Quad. So this is La Trappe Quad, 10%.
Woo!
Yeah, I mean, just give it like a...
I'm getting like a... almost like a banana scent.
Yeah.
Yes.
Twizzlers. Strawberry.
Oh, totally.
Right?
Yeah. I've never heard that, but now I'm thinking that.
Someone said I get Twizzlers, which is...
Oh, my God.
Right?
Totally Twizzlers.
Twizzlers.
Yeah, I totally
right?
stopped.
Wow. Wait, what was
I love Twizzlers.
What were the little Twizzlers? Nibs.
Not Red Vines.
Nibs. Yeah. Nibs,
not
right?
Red Vines.
Not Red Vines. Cheers.
Wow.
Skull.
Cheers.
Cheers.
Oh, my goodness. Cheers.
Skull.
Now, is this made by monks now? Or
yes,
is
this is one of the Trappist breweries in the world.
Okay.
Yeah.
Wow.
I believe there's 12 right now, yeah, so.
Wow, and this is one of the 12. Yeah.
So this beer is made at a monastery where monks live, work, and pray, basically, and nothing else.
And get hammered.
And on
10% beer.
you also have to donate to a charity. Part of the proceeds of your beer has to go towards a charity. It's made at a monastery, and the monks oversee the labels, the recipe, the charity work, and they all kind of hang out and keep in touch with each other and keep each other in check. Yeah. So if you're messing around and you're not playing by the rules, you're not allowed to be in a Trappist monastery, a Trappist brewery anymore.
And now, are they the silent monks?
Not anymore.
Only when they drink.
they eat in silence.
Yeah.
I got to go to the monastery and they listen to classical music and eat pretty simple food.
Yeah.
In silence.
And do they have beer with their food? Every
sometimes.
Day?
Yeah.
And I believe that this is the first quad ever created.
Oh, really?
Yeah, this is the first quad ever created by the Trappe.
What was it? Last year we celebrated the 25th anniversary of the quad.
Yeah.
Oh, wow.
Yeah. Here in the U.S., actually, there are a couple of bars and establishments which have been given the honor of being sort of La Trappe representatives.
Yeah, governors. Trappist governorships.
Where they have been recognized by La Trappe to be governors here in the U.S. to serve and support the whole ideology behind La Trappe.
So they're serving that. Here they make sure they have the glass.
You gotta have the glass. Oh yeah. Yep.
Everything is done.
Have the glass. One of them on one Trappist beer on tap. 10 on bottle. And the correct glass. Yeah, it's cool.
It's an honor.
How to be faithfully.
this is a metal beer. Right, so our second to last beer, Alex. What have we got?
Cuvée de Jacobins Rouge. This is the same brewery as the Omer, the brewery Omer Vandergens. This is their Flemish Red. Very, very sour, intense beer.
So yeah, good. You can smell the red fruity.
Oh, yeah. Woo! An old style of beer from like the late 1800s, back before they had, refrigeration and closed tanks. Woo! Everything was fermented on an open cool ship. It's like a giant copper bath.
Just
they pump the beer out there. They keep the windows open, let the beer chill overnight, cool down.
The bacteria
interact with
air,
the bacteria. Yeah. Maybe a spider if he wants to hang out. That's all right. And then after that, overnight it cools down, and they ship it into giant oak fooders, which are about 10 feet wide, 15 feet tall. Sit in there for 18 months.
18 months.
And the fooders are porous, so they interact with air a little bit as well. So the beer, as it sits, it gets more and more and more intense in flavor.
So with all of this beer on the table, what could be the grand finale of our beer tasting expedition?
I mean, I think it would be appropriate, these are pretty metal beers, right? I mean,
these are metal beers, but there could be a more metal one.
So I think I've had these waiting for a while in my cellar, and I figured that this would be the most appropriate.
What could be more metal than Iron Maiden's Trooper 666 beer?
And I think.
Wait a minute.
Yeah.
What's that?
So,
it's the smallest glass we could find.
Yeah, so this is the smallest. So I think we should just pour it in here and we should all just kind of drink out of
it. Dump it all over us.
Yeah.
Now, what is the 666 Trooper beer? That's a different flavor.
It's what Eddie drinks.
It's what Eddie drinks. Nice. Yeah, so 5 years ago, Trooper beer was created by Iron Maiden and Robinson's Brewery in England.
Bruce Dickinson is really into beer, right?
Like, yes, very passionate.
Yeah.
He.
May I take the first?
Yeah, so. Yeah, please. I believe, Richard, you should be the.
So understand all the wasted time searching for those wasted beers. There's no wasted beers here.
We are all wasted off beers.
We are all getting wasted off beers. There you go. Oh my God, that is delicious. Go for it, Seth.
Get inside me, Eddie.
Nico, this is for you if you're watching.
Oh, and the bottle.
That is delicious.
Bottle.
That is so crisp.
This is the perfect gift for any metalhead beer drinker.
Totally. Yeah.
Any metalhead that gets a bottle of Iron Maiden beer as a gift, it's the greatest gift ever.
Once a year, we release metal tins, branded metal tins with the bottle and a pint glass.
Oh, around the holidays?
Yeah. Look out for it in the fall.
Oh, nice.
Yeah, we'll have holiday time. Gift tins on its way.
You guys want to start drinking?
Yeah, let's.
Drinking. Well, we got to finish off a lot of this.
We have some beers to finish off. We want to thank you for sticking with us. We hope you learned something. I want to thank everyone for listening and watching. I don't even know where I am right now because I'm so drunk. Alex, Seth, Richard, thank you for hanging out with us. Thank you for drinking And thank you.
Thank you for having us
at the bar. Yeah. Woo! Woo!